What I often find surprising about the psoas is how far back it is in the body. I often think of the psoas like in front of my organs, but it's even behind the kidneys, right? Which are all the way in the back body, and I have a picture of the kidneys here that we can see them. And it's starting that high up.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I know, right? And then the other really, really cool thing about it is that it, where the anterior cruciate ligaments of, the anterior cruciate ligaments of the diaphragm here, these ones that come down, these little legs, diaphragm legs, cross where the psoas comes up in the back of the body. Okay, so here's all my muscles, the muscles on this model. And if we go all the way in, it's much easier for me to do this on my phone because I can, this one takes some learning how to drive it. Here we are. So here's the anterior cruciate ligaments of the diaphragm. These ones that come down here. And if we go even less muscles.
Wow, that's amazing.
That's cool. So let's do one more layer. Here's the diaphragm. And here's the anterior cruciate ligaments coming down here. And they go down different amounts for each person, but they were not the same, or everyone's not the same. And then the psoas comes up and crosses them from behind. We do breathing by contracting the fibers of the diaphragm to inhale, which pulls lung air into the lungs. And then we don't do exhaling. We stop doing. And we release the diaphragm to exhale, which allows it to come up, and then the breath comes in. And then we do the in-breath by contraction. And then we have to somehow let go, which is why when people get really tight, when their breathing gets shallow, people often say, take a deep breath, you're breathing so shallow, you're not breathing. And then what they do is they do more breath by, do more contraction of the diaphragm to breathe in. But really, the reason they're not taking a deep breath is most likely because the fibers aren't letting go. So we can't really do that, we just have to stop the effort. Like, it takes a deep trust that if we let go of these fibers, there's gonna be air to come in again, right? Which is why it's so tricky to tell someone to breathe deeply when they're not breathing deeply, because it really just, they often will get actually more tight in their diaphragm. So that's related to the psoas, and that the diaphragm, the amount of movement that our diaphragm has, which is actually very small, the actual movement of the diaphragm, directly affects how our psoas is going to be responding to our breath with each breath, right? So this rhythmic letting go and inhaling and letting go and inhaling is going to impact our psoas is moving or not moving. Yeah? Does that make sense? You can see that. Isn't that cool how it's really just feeding it also into the quad arteries? And then you can see here that picture of the kidneys and the anterior to the psoas. So the psoas is coming. Let me just see this. Here's another picture of the diaphragm and the psoas, and they really do look like a jellyfish, and it has those long, like the psoas is kind of like those, the anterior cruciate ligaments of the diaphragm that come down, and then the psoas in the back, and it's like this jellyfish. So I like to think sometimes of my diaphragm almost like it's like the psoas is like a suspension of the diaphragm.
Do they have a contracting or like opposite contracting relationship?
Oh, I don't know. Let's explore that. So that's such a great question. I mean, I'm imagining as the diaphragm inhales, it contracts, it would impact the contraction of those fibers, right? I mean, this is such an old school model that we have all these different muscles. Like, and when we really look at the muscles, they're actually just kind of like one big muscle. It can be a big muscle in the body. And so I like to always think of the diaphragm when we're talking about the psoas in that way. And then the other thing about the psoas that so here's the spine, the lumbar, and here's T12. And we can know that the fibers of the psoas connect at the anterior, the front of these transverse processes of the vertebra, and inferior, and the lower border of the anterior surface. Yeah, the front lower, and they come down and cross over the side of the pubis and connect to the lesser minor trochanter of the femur, which is surprisingly posterior on the femur, right? It's not, it's like the psoas is really going posterior again. So it starts posterior, like in the back body, comes to the front, and then goes back to the back body again. So if we look at that, how that actually happens. Like, let's see, this is my...
Should I hold something up?
Thanks so much, I think I got it. Mm-hmm. This is the top of the psoas at T12. And then it's connected to all these transverse vertebrae here at the front. Yeah?
This is a muscle vesta.
And then,
you tie it around.
I'm just tying it around a bit. So it's coming down here, and then it's going over. It's all the pelvic organs, the uterus, all of these, the belly, all the intestines are all sitting in the anterior to it, right? And then it's coming down and crossing like a pulley, and it's going to the lesser trochanter, the back body again. Which means when we contract these fibers, it's going to bring us into external rotation and flexion of the hip, of the femur. The femur is going to externally rotate, and there's going to be hip flexion. Yeah? So if we have joint centrifugation of the femur, the head of the femur into the acetabulum of the hip, which means this is going to stay, so these surfaces are going to be articulating, the smooth surfaces are going to be articulating with these smooth surfaces, then this muscle will cause external rotation and hip flexion in an arc.
Can you palpate it? Is that,
yeah, we're going to do that next, totally. Oh, you mean the lesser trochanter? Some people can, who are really thin. I have a very hard time finding my lesser trochanter, but some people are able to.
But the pelvic bone, you can feel the pelvic bone, right? But
this thing, yeah.
Yeah. But is this psoas way over and it's hidden?
We'll lay on the floor in a second and get there. But I just wanted to say one more thing about the psoas major, is that, and iliacus is here. It used to be one muscle, right? The iliopsoas, and in my lifetime, made it into two muscles. But if we don't do external rotation of the femur and we simply lift the leg in a monoplane with only lifting it in this plane instead of a triaxial motion, the psoas doesn't have that same wind-up quality. See how it just gets kind of lax? So it doesn't have as much potential for spring, because if you looked at that picture, the psoas, the fibers of the psoas are running superior to inferior, down top to bottom. So as we contract the fibers, there's like a winding up, like whoosh, whoosh, right, that's allowing a really nice springy wind up, release. Wind up, release. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
So when you move your leg like this, I'm finding I'm taking deep breaths. So am I stimulating the diaphragm somehow?
Yay! That sounds good.
Sounds
for consent.
Yeah.
And then we're going to go in, and it's pretty tricky to feel. You can feel the iliacus, but I would say you can just be, don't be creepy with your partner, but you can, with consent, kind of feel into her femur. Like, I feel like that's your, is that your mind right there?
No, that's like my, the shaft of my femur, I feel like. Wouldn't it be more anterior?
It's actually really posterior. That's the kind of the surprising thing
I don't know, maybe it was.
About the lesser trochanter is it's much more in the back body than in the front. Right? Which is why it causes so much external rotation as we lift the leg.
Maybe
so with our partner, we're gonna feel in to the front of the vertebra. This is the body of the vertebra here. And I'm gonna trace the outline of the psoas. It's very, very deep, right?
Right.
And
it's in the back.
So it's coming from the side of the front of the vertebra, down to the lesser trochanter to here. So as this muscle contracts, this leg is going to come into external rotation, femur bone. But we're going to do not only a distal movement of the leg by contraction of the psoas, but also having her body, her torso, excuse me, also move proximally. Meaning proximal means if there's movement from the spine, like a closer, this is the center in this kind of anatomical lingo, and the closer you are to here, it's a proximal initiation. So this is a distal initiation.
Mm-hmm.
So if she moves proximally, she can also lift. She's going to side tilt. Yeah, she's going to side tilt, which we did this a little bit on Monday when we talked about side bending. Right, distal initiation, proximal.
Huh.
Let your leg bend, your knee bend, excuse me. So we're going to practice proximal initiation. These terms of, in anatomical terms of origin and insertion are very, like, totally randomly placed based on, I think, probably a dead person, right? And like what's closest to the person dissecting them. So here we're using proximal initiation to, and this is the key piece for people that were here many that was really missing in a lot of the work we were doing with the star.
Then you can see it on.
Okay. So with a partner, so you're gonna just practice this kind of like, I like to think of sometimes like a clock that I'm going, and then I'm going, and I'm switching the side bend using my. So I'm moving the psoas from here. To a star shape, and then back up again.
The star is when you So
as I'm letting the fibers of my psoas contract here, it's gonna bring me into a side bend or lateral oscillation or a lateral rotation of the lower spine, which is different than this. Star shape to flexion of the pelvis.
Just to repeat because it was a bit different.
Yeah.
So you thinking of the, let's say around T12 and this?
Yeah.
Moving towards each other.
And all the longer star shape. I'm gonna initiate the side bend. Lateral flexion actually from my psoas. I'm trying to initiate my psoas. So at the same time that I'm moving my lumbar spine and my T12 towards my lesser trochanter, I'm moving my lesser trochanter towards those spaces at the same time. And it's going to pull me up into a, whatever this pigeon, whatever you want to call this. And then this psoas is getting more of a lengthening as the psoas is getting a shortening, right? And then I'm going to come across so that I don't crunch onto the psoas at all.
Oh, sorry, can you go back to that?
Yeah, I'll go back to everything. Coming around. Here my psoas is lengthening and this one's shortening. Coming aside. And then this side is going to start to lengthen, and it's still on the side that I'm going for. It's come back into the star shape. And then here our left side is going to start to contract from both ends. Until it brings me into the same shape, pigeon shape. And again, this one's lengthening and this one's shortening. And you're going to come up and over. And then this one's opening, this one's contracting. Using my arm here, or what we talked about on Monday and Wednesday, is rolling over and pushing with the lateral side of the arm, catching myself on my other arm and pad. And I would encourage, you might just want to pause each time you get to the start of your arm. Oh, there's the psoas. Oh, there's the other psoas. My psoas. You might want to take a little moment with each of these places. Yeah?
Can you continue? I have a question.
Yeah.
If you continue. And just around the star shape. Right. And actually, so what I've been, I'm very focused on that and on the side bending.
Yeah.
And I've noticed the question for myself. Tend to have tension in my neck to hold up the head, and I'm actually not sure should it because I'm thinking of my arms not being here, but being in an economic tension with my. But then I do hold my neck, and I was wondering if you're supposed to or if you don't. Or
part of it is that the triaxial muscles. And my counsel would be to let the head laterally flex and also rotate on the vertical axis.
Yeah.
To let yourself come up, because if it only laterally flexes, then this does feel like really stressful on my neck.
It's not super stressful what I experienced, but I think
I don't know
what is necessary and what is not.
Yeah. And then if I gotta go head towards the pelvis and have that the lateral flexion of the rotation, there's like a meow sneaking, I'm sorry, a meow sneaking up.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Yeah? And on the way down, similarly, the pelvis torso head. I'm switching my right.